Welcome to Talentwise, the definitive podcast for CXOs, human resource and learning and development leaders. This show comes to you from thought leaders who talk about human capital development in today's organization. How to engage and empower today's employee to be effective, competitive and relevant. Stay with us for an exciting conversation with our guest and learn how to future-proof your team. I'm your host Shubhanjan, founder of Knowledge Bridge. Our guest today is Subbu Iyer, Chief Designer, Architect and CEO of Harim. The three things that he exists for are design, transformation and innovation.
When we talk about future-proofing, I think the first aspect that needs attention is us humans. Whether it is society, whether it is organizations, we need to start seeing ourselves as intellectual property producers. Human resources, but when you say resources, you are using them for a very specific requirement. And it means that, you know, they were trained on it and they were used for it. That was good for the, you know, economy where, you know, you had one leader and or a bunch of people who basically laid down the policies, principles and procedures and asked the rest of the organization to follow. And I think that is a dramatic shift, whether you're talking about organizations or society, where people or individuals do not want to be tethered in that manner. Secondly, you know, diversity is not a fashion statement. So as a consequence of the first one, when we start seeing ourselves as intellectual property producers, diversity is an automatic inheritance of that, in the sense that the choices that we make as intelligent human beings. So what is required is not training, but a learning platform where it is safe to fail, where, and you fail quickly and you learn and you and then basically you action that learning in terms of tangible outcomes for the society.
Subbu has designed and architected software products such as AIMS, acquired by Digital, the first successful B2C global application for American Express Property, Casualty and Contribution Management, later acquired by Maersk. He has led large transformation programs for the South African Revenue Services, transforming the taxation administration of an entire country. He's acknowledged visionary with the ability to lead solutions design, architecture, and the development from the center with expertise in AI, ML, NLP, and intelligent automation. Now, on to this great episode of Talentwise with Subbu Iyer. Subbu, welcome to Talentwise. It's so nice that you could find time and join us for the show today. What do you see from your vantage point are the factors that will impact organizations as they get ready for the future? Sticking to the theme of future-proofing your team, what do you see are the core challenges?
Shubhanjan, thanks for having me. It's a pleasure being on the show. When we talk about future-proofing, I think the first aspect that needs attention is us humans. Whether it is society, whether it is organizations, we need to start seeing ourselves as intellectual property producers. Secondly, you know, diversity is not a fashion statement. So as a consequence of the first one, when we start seeing ourselves as intellectual property producers, diversity is an automatic inheritance of that, in the sense that the choices that we make as intelligent human beings. And in doing that, diversity then becomes global, because, you know, as humanity has for a long period of time, as its evolution happened, been from local, has slowly progressed to global. Today, global is an inevitability. You know, whether you like it or not, whether you can be in a physical presence, you are virtually there. So I think this great divide today, the third aspect, which is the globality, means, you know, reducing the divide between the physical and the virtual. And I think these three aspects are really the key for departing from the present into the future. And that is something that we need to take cognizance of and start working on as both organizations and society, Shubhanjan.
So tell me, let's expand on the first one. You are engaged with multiple industries, helping them through this transformation. How do you see they're tackling this concept that don't look at your employees merely as human resource or assets, to
No, these people are actually capable of adding value, creating processes, creating ideas, which means they bring something more than pure labor.
Human resources, but when you say resources, you are using them for a very specific requirement. And it means that, you know, they were trained on it and they were used for it. That was good for the, you know, economy where, you know, you had one leader and or a bunch of people who basically laid down the policies, principles and procedures and asked the rest of the organization to follow. And I think that is a dramatic shift, whether you're talking about organizations or society, where people or individuals do not want to be tethered in that manner. They want a right to express themselves, to express their talent, which is talent is basically the expression of the latent, which is in them. And to provide, therefore, so what is required is not training, but a learning platform where it is safe to fail, and you fail quickly, and you learn, and then basically you action that learning in terms of tangible outcomes for the society. So I think that is basically where I'm going with, in terms of saying that the first aspect that we need is to incorporate that responsibility of designing the future and not arriving at the future by accident. You know, as organizations have evolved, you know, from the Ford, which said, you know, I will make only black cars, to today when you see, you know, customer says, I want this type of car, which then gets assembled, is a huge shift. So when we have these shifts in the landscape, you know, why it is a tragedy if we don't look, for example, at human beings who actually make this happen, make the transition too. So just as much as the power of personalizing and preferentiating every single transaction for a customer exists, I think the key aspect here is to look at human beings as being able to engine that preferentiation and personalization through a very deep profiling. What that actually means is giving the individuals the ability to make a choice. So what needs to happen is to recognize that, be cognizant of that, shift to the landscape, enable this generation in terms of becoming intellectual property producers, not just human resources.
So one point is that while we are all talking of this shift from, this whole tribal society to the agrarian society to the sovereign state society, and now to be a global citizen, so on and so forth, you can also see very definite move towards back to, you know, people trying to move back from globalization. In fact, yesterday I wrote an article in LinkedIn about how Russia, Syria, North Korea and a bunch of other countries are talking of sovereign internet, for example. So they don't want to be part of the global internet because of X number of reasons. I mean, I will not go into that. That's a more a geopolitical issue. But a lot of people in power or in positions of power have contrarian views and where they want the society to be, I mean, which might delay what you are saying or predicting by a few decades or maybe whatever. So my question is, what kind of manifestation do you see with the companies that you are engaged with now of this particular thought?
You have actually nailed the coffin, Shubhanjan, because, you know, you also answered the question in a certain way. Is the vested interests, the leaders at the highest level know what they are doing. You know, they know, for example, that they are retarding the progress that society is required to make. But they do not allow the progress because it is not in their best interest. They do not know how to handle it. And I will speak from my personal experience. You know, I have actually created a fifth generation payments solution, which is device channel and medium independent, at almost zero cost in a previous organization. And the same thing was built by a consulting company in the headquarters for $3.5 million with just 5% of the code. Whereas the solution I built with rookies had, this solution exists in the organization, but guess what happened? They wanted to give a $30 million contract to the consulting company to continue building that nascent solution that they have built instead of actually looking at this 100% intellectual property that is built within the organization. Now, these are not people who do not know technology. These are not people who do not know solution. It is simply the fact that, how do they control that power? So I think to your question, though we know this, that the thing called intellectual integrity is absent to a large extent in most organizations, in most societies. There will always be at any given point in time in civilization and history, there will always be a resistance from the incumbents for something that is new, because they're just not prepared for it. They're just not ready to support it. And it also happens to be that, they have the power and the authority at this particular point in time. And this is where we need to learn from history. History has seen bloody revolutions followed by peaceful nonviolence, which has taken a number of years. So really, what do we need to learn from this transition in history is, how do you become smart? How can they make these smart choices, smart decisions, smart solutions? And how do they publish it in such a way that it becomes a democratic movement? It doesn't become a revolution, but it becomes a part of a much catalyst evolution, And I think that's what our societies need. And in that sense, it is not a few people, but it is a majority who need to embrace design.
And how does that now, this whole bunch of thoughts that we discussed now, how does it connect with your thought about diversity and how the role that plays in future-proofing a team?
So, which is basically a natural flowing phenomena, if you say diversity, the thing called diversity is all about the kind of choices that people make. It is just not whether you're born into a certain religion, caste, creed, geography, or you adopt a certain lifestyle. You make certain choices in terms of, what your sexuality is. This is diversity. And this diversity is what is making an individual in terms of their identity. Now, until this point in time, our societies have focused a lot on that kind of individuality, that kind of identity in terms of, labeling people that, are you gay or are you a Brahmin or are you a Indian or are you a Southpaw? So instead of looking at these are all the little, kind of attributes leading to a particular dimension of a personality. I think if you really start refocusing that, and start focusing on making a knowledge-enabled society. We're talking about growth. We're talking about a society that is seeing. There is a lot of progress. That is because of the inclusion of the globality. The Western world and the Southeastern world and the rest of the world have merged into India, and India has always gone out. It is not now, but that is the history of the civilization, that they have gone out and they have spread themselves. So I think that osmosis is basically what is contributing to the growth. And as we progress as a society, instead of promoting that osmosis, whether it is in organizations, I know of several organizations that you may call multinationals, or you call them offshore centers in India or captive centers in India. The attempt is to a large extent the same slave mentality that used to exist in terms of saying my masters are in Britain or France or Netherlands. So, I'm going to wait for them to instruct. I'm going to basically place my ears on the ground and see what their mood is, right? And I think that trading mentality, that mentality of subserviality, needs to change. And the present generation is like that, children in your home and my home and everywhere else, you will see a very different attitude because they have not had to go through the socioeconomic circumstances of our previous generations. So they come born free. They don't understand this concept of being subserving. And so they need to find expression in terms of their talent. And they're having the economic ability to, seek education in different parts of the world and contribute and become these wonderful people other than just being, engineers and doctors. So what that is, we need to see this globality from a diverse point of view, incorporate that into our lives, and you know, and be able to bring that to work. You know, we need to stop focusing on these different aspects, you know, guide the future generation in terms of recreating the society, because you know, we need in every single one of those seven stations, and at the cost of sounding repetitive, I would say focus, you know, whether I'm doing software development work, I can still focus my solutions based on what is the environment impact, what is the health impact, what is the wealth impact, what is the technology impact, what is the mobility impact, what is the governance impact. I can still do this and I can build solutions. So I think diversity from that point of view has to be mutually inclusive. Most human societies do not have this understanding of mutual inclusivity, whether it is building, they are very comfortable in their zones of mutual exclusivity. And I think that this is a fundamental shift. And I'm not talking only about India. This is true to a large extent in developed societies as well. And I've had the benefit of living in most places and being in the corporate environments and senior leadership roles all over the world. So, you know, it is safe for me to say, and I can, you know, this time is short here, but, you know, that this aspect of mutual exclusivity in the, being the comfort zone for most human beings needs to shift into mutual inclusivity. And that essentially is what I call diversity. And where, you know, you can allow people to experiment, to fail early, to learn from anywhere, to change the rules, to make new rules. You know, it is easy to say all these things, and you will see them in a plethora text in on the internet. But this is not what happens in real life. In real life, you are not allowed to fail. You're not allowed to experiment. There is no learning in action, right? Because when you learn in action, all these things happen. You do make rules because this, you think this is the new thing that needs to happen. So I think that is where I'm talking about that, you know, we need to have diversity. And in corporates especially, and this is my bottom point for all this, you know, if you do not recognize, so when we talk about customers in the conventional society, a customer, a definition of a customer was someone who pays in exchange for, you know, the money that for the services or products that they seek or get delivered to them. We need to change that definition today and understand that, you know, customer is not just the client, but he's also the team member, a shareholder, a stakeholder, a business partner, a vendor, or a society in which a particular enterprise or business operates. Why? Because they're all contributing to that economic factor of economic value in terms of how an enterprise thrives and survives. And unless and until any organization changes its definition and creates these interconnecting processes, this thing called diversity that they use just to, you know, hire women or people of sexual orientation and show that as diversity is rubbish.
Let's take a short break. When we come back, we'll find out from Subbu how far companies have assimilated these concepts of globality, diversity, and teams as creators of intellectual property into their work culture.
You are listening to a Show How To audio original. Podcasting is one of the fastest growing content marketing avenues today. We can help you exploit this largely untapped marketing opportunity. We can craft your audio strategy and leverage the wide reach and easy streaming capability that smartphone penetration provides. It is powerful and personal. Talk to us to find out how podcasting can help you build your brand and reach out to target audiences.
Welcome back. Before the break, Subbu was discussing the three key concepts of globality, diversity, and teams as creators of intellectual property that were necessary for prepping our organizations for the future. Let's find out if companies have embraced these ideas and to what extent.
How do you see these three things, globality, diversity, and looking at the team as actually creators of intellectual property? How do you see these three things actually being embraced by organizations which are focused into the future and are doing or implementing these thoughts today?
So making every individual an instrument of transformation is essential and vital. I think for a second, if we, you know, pause ourselves, you know, think about it, whether we are, whether I'm speaking from the perspective of a citizen of our of a country or a citizen of a corporate or even a my own company, you know, I have to ask myself that question. Am I being an instrument of transformation? And, you know, we don't have to pause too much. You know, we are not an instrument of transformation. We have been an instrument of convenience. And I think this is the this is a major shift. One, and it's a very, very deep thing that we need to realize. And in order to do that, now I'm coming down to answering the how of, you know, making that transformation, right? So human beings have always been ingenuous and will continue to be ingenuous. They will have great ideas. So there have been people who have created ideas for convenience. There have been people who have created ideas for societal wellness. There have been people who have created ideas for, you know, transforming our society from, you know, kind of a threshold of capability into another threshold of capability. So there have been people all the time. There have been in human history on this planet, there has been never a dearth for ideas. Except that we have lived in different parts of the world unconnected. Today we are a connected society. So now is the time when, you know, disparate ideas need to get clustered into concepts. Why they need to do that is because, you know, these concepts have a larger, greater, faster, and more deeper impact on our lives than just disparate ideas. Example, right? You know, building an app for an appointment with a doctor, okay? It's not a bad idea, right? It's a great idea. But what will I do after getting the appointment? What will the doctor do after getting the appointment? How is it really going to improve the quality of life? Is the question I need to ask. Maybe I don't have the ability to carve out that entire quality of life, but I am sure that there are 500 different Einsteins across all the world, okay, who have different pieces of that idea to make that construct. Why should we wait in sequence, okay, in order for that to form by itself? Is there a way in which today we talk so much about, you know, machine intelligence and artificial intelligence? No, that is the job of machine intelligence and artificial intelligence. This is the job of algorithm, you know, bringing the aspects of matching, validation, interpolation, and creating the catalytic effect of, you know, bringing the changes in real time. So why are we not doing it? So the idea, therefore, is that the conceptualization stage, we need to have the ability to abstract these dots that are across the globe, connectivity, right? And connecting them into concepts more quickly. Now, these concepts are nothing but models. Now, these models, now this is the second part, is the question that we talked about earlier, Shubhanjan, which is failure, fear of failure, right? So if you, why do you fear failure? Is because you have, so this is one path, and if I do not progress on this path, I will die, right? But if you had multiple paths, what would you do? You would take these, you know, you would have a plan A, you're going to a plan B, you're going to a plan Z. The problem with our societies has been, right, you know, that in engineering, which is the next step of conceptualization, has always been seen from a single aspect. You know, few industries like automobile industries, they started developing multiple lines of manufacture. They have multiple lines of products. But we have not adapted that into other forms of our society. So we still have a single track. We have a single assembly line, and we do not want that assembly line to fail. But and we confuse the design of design with the design of abstraction. So in engineering is basically one that is not meant to create a product, but actually break a product. So, you know, when you break a product, then you see multiple ways in which it can be implemented. So we still do not understand the concept of how to, the engineering where, you know, you allow something to fail, you optimize, that is the optimization limit. And then you regress back in terms of saying what is an applicable product. So we need to understand, recreate this and reimagine what engineering really is, which means that, you know, you have multiple lines of a particular product, which means you can see them as engines, components, and connectors. So this is what is basically built in engineering, and then that becomes industrialization, which is then you take the right combination of this engine. So, you know, if you can build a 5,000 megawatts engine, but this 5,000 megawatts engine may be good for flying, but what you need on the road is a 1,000 megawatt engine, right? And you put both these assembly lines in industrialization. So this multiple mutual inclusivity is basically what that industrialization should be. And then the commercialization of it is the customer doesn't know everything. You know, this is a line that was made famous by Herb Keller, the chairman of Southwest Airlines. And he had the guts to say that when he began Southwest Airlines. So, you know, I think we need to know that there needs to be a process of education, ownership, and commitment, where actually more than all the money that you put into or you invest into advertising, marketing, branding after creating a product, right? That pyramid needs to be inverted. It needs to be done before creating so that, you know, a customer can understand what is it that they need to aspire for rather than what is it that they need to expect in terms of a product. So today, a lot of the money that is spent, if you look at any organization's SG&A expense, the maximum is spent on product campaigning, on selling a product. You know, that needs to be reversed in terms of building capability and positioning capability. And if you can then see that as, you know, creating the aspiration. Now, I'm not saying this in abstract. It's because, you know, the reason why I say we need to start thinking of customer aspiration is, you know, from a very simple thing like that, when we go out into a cinema theater, you know, how can we be healthy? How can we avoid plastic? How can we, every single thing that we buy, we come into contact that we see is in some way or the other connected with what, you know, businesses have built for us around us. So how do we educate the customer? How do we get them to own it? And how can it be profitable both ways? Is a collaborative aspect that needs education, ownership, and commitment. So, you know, to me, this progression, and this is my summary of your question, is the progression from conceptualization, which is basically connecting the ideas around the globe, from ideas into concepts and clustering them, and then moving them into multiple solutions, which is basically seen as a form of engineering, connectors, and components, and then taking them on appropriately to the global market in terms of versions and releases through products and platform, product, process, and projects or services, to basically ensuring that the customer is realizing value. So this is a connected process. And whether it is a service organization, whether it is a product organization, whether it is a platform organization, I think this aspect of connecting the conceptualization to commercialization is absolutely vital. They need to see this architecture. They need to implement this architecture. They need to connect them through these processes and enable people in the organization to become intellectual property producers. So this is where your intellectual property gets transported in a continuum, you know, through the process of conceptualization to engineering, to industrialization, to commercialization, through automated stage gate processes. When you have automated stage gate processes, they risk assure, they become the catalyst, and they allow the transportation of intellectual property from conceptualization to commercialization. I think that's basically where, you know, tying these three aspects of producing IP, creating diversity and making diversity a strength, and actually then allowing the transformation and innovation to happen on a continuous basis, not just as a mouth service, will benefit our society and organizations.
Talentwise is brought to you by Knowledge Bridge. We produce customized and multilingual visual training content. We have worked on complex processes, products, and skills development for large blue chip brands such as Tata Motors, Mahindra First Choice, HomeLane, Epson, Toyota, Citibank, and Consul Neowatt, serving diverse industries. Talk to us for your next custom content requirement and be pleasantly surprised. Call us on 99021-631-32.
Wonderful, Subbu. That was great. I really enjoyed chatting with you, and I hope that we will catch up again in some form soon. Before I let you go, will you just tell if folks who are listening to this podcast, if they want to get in touch with you, how should they do that?
Absolutely. Thank you. First of all, thank you very much, Shubhanjan, for this opportunity. Really appreciate. I enjoyed the conversation as well. Anyone who wants to reach me can basically send me a mail, subbu@hreemm.io, cream.io. And my mobile number is country code 91-97413-64524. Happy to be able to answer any questions and connect with anyone that is seeking something in the space.
Wonderful. Have a great day and we'll talk soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you for being with us today on Talentwise. We hope we helped you focus on some actionable ideas today. It was certainly enlightening for us. We hope to see you again on our next episode. If you liked what you heard, subscribe to the show in your favorite podcast platforms like iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or wherever else you get your podcasts from, and give us a rating while you're at it. Thank you in advance. This Show How To Original podcast is produced for KnowledgeBridge, the multilingual visual training platform and custom training content creators by Show How To Audio. Hosted by Shubhanjan Sarkar and produced by Rajiv Aditya. See you next time.